Welcome to our program. Our motto is repent, unite, and rebuild. Turn away from your sins, unite as a people, and rebuild the community and the nation, okay, of the 12 tribes of Israel and the church of Yeshua HaMashiach. And so what happened to the Israelites is that they started forsaking or forgetting about God, forgetting about the truth, forgetting about judgment and justice, and they became corrupt. And that's why they fell. I'm going to read that. This is Deuteronomy chapter 32. I'm going to read from verse 16. But Jeshurun, which is the Israelites, Jerusalem, waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxen fat. Thou art grown thick. Thou art covered with fatness. We became very wealthy. Okay? Fatness. Then he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. So we started counting on our own wisdom and on our own wealth for salvation rather than counting on God. Okay? We started making our own religions, thinking we could make our own wisdom be so proud. Okay? They provoke him to jealousy. They start making God jealous. With strange gods, with abominations, provoked they him to anger. So that's why we fell, because we forsook God and started setting up false gods. Okay? Nobody caused us to fall. We caused ourselves to fall. Nobody caused us to go into slavery. We caused ourselves to go into slavery. Nobody caused us to suffer. We caused ourselves, because we forsook God and we failed to keep the commandments of God. No one is to be blamed for this but ourselves. Of course, whosoever is taking advantage of that will also be punished by God. Because when a man is down, you don't kick him. So whoever is taking advantage of the 12 tribes of Israel will also be punished for that. Okay. They provoke him to jealousy with strange gods. Okay, with abominations provoke they him to anger. They sacrifice unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. For example, our people put up this picture for Jesus. Okay, this is not Jesus Christ. The person who modeled for this picture, his name was César Borgia, the second son of Pope Alexander of Rome, okay? But originally, Christ was a person of Afro-Asiatic descent, like the rest of the 12 tribes of Israel, okay? In chapter 17, God said that he will remove those tribes from northern Israel, okay? So 2 Kings 17, verse 10, and they set them up images and groves in every high hill and under every green tree, like the Christmas tree. That's against the commandment of God to put up a Christmas tree. A Christmas tree is an idol. It tells you that in Genesis chapter 10, in Jeremiah chapter 10, I'm going to read that for you. So you could see that why our people suffer is because they have idols in their homes. The Christmas tree is an idol, okay? Because the Christmas tradition is actually from the Babylonian. It's the worship of the winter solstice. It's a winter solstice sun worshiping custom. Christ was not born in December. And in Jeremiah chapter 10, God said not to put up the Christmas tree, because after the king of Babylon died, people used to bring gold and silver to the king. The king was buried under a tree, so now they bring the gold and silver to the tree. That's why the Christmas tree has the gold on it. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 1. It's a little sidetracked, but I'll read this. Hear ye the word which the Lord speak unto you, O house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord God, learn not the way of the heathen. The way means the tradition and customs of the people, because that's exactly why you're going into slavery. That's exactly why you're poor. That's exactly why you're suffering, because you're following traditions of churches and men and governments and cultures that you're just a colonial cultures rather than the truth of God in the Bible, the commandments of God. Following tradition is why you're going into slavery, why you're poor, why you're suffering, why you get sick, and why you die. Following and keeping the commandments of God is how you'll be successful and come out of poverty and suffering and pain. For as long as you keep calling yourself by derogatory names and adjectives and false identities, you'll suffer. The minute you turn back to God as an Israelite and keeping his commandments and following Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, then you will have success. Okay? Hear the word which the Lord speak unto you, O house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of the heavens. Okay, astrology and all of this, we're not supposed to follow that. For the heathens are dismayed at them. Okay, For the customs of the people are vain. All these things you're following, they don't benefit you, okay? Putting up a Christmas tree and all these things, causing a fire in your house and all this crazy madness, okay? For the customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen with the axe. Just like that tree at Rockefeller Center. They go out in the forest, they chop it down with an axe, right? The Bible is telling you about that, okay? Verse 4, they deck it with silver and with gold. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 4, okay? When you see a Christmas tree, they have the gold and silver trimmings. It tells you that in the Bible, okay? So you know it's talking about the Christmas tree. They fasten it with nails and with hammer that it move not. They are upright as the palm tree, okay? Okay, they are upright as the palm tree, but speak not. They must needs be born because they cannot go. They have to carry, it from the store and put it there because it's not a god. You decorate it like you decorate an idol. Okay, you put it up like you put up an idol. At the December 24th, 25th, that's the winter solstice. You're worshiping the sun when you're putting up a Christmas tree. You're putting up a false god in your house. That's one of the many things you do that's wrong. When you keep Sunday instead of the Saturday, that's another thing. The Sabbath is Saturday, not Sunday. Sunday is sun worship. Christmas is winter solstice celebration. It was called the Feast of Saturnalia in Rome. Okay, Christ was not born in December. So going on, this is why we're in slavery. This is why we fell, because we went into false customs and traditions. And they set up images and groves, okay? In your house, you got this image. You think it's Jesus and God. You put that up in your house. You're not supposed to put any images and idols in your house. The Bible, that's the first and second commandment. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. Thou shalt not, you don't know that. You know exactly what I'm saying is true, okay? So going back to the reason why we fell, right? And they set up images and groves in every high hills and under every green tree, and they... And there they burned incense in all the high places, as did the heathens, from the Lord, whom the Lord carried away before them and wrought wicked things to provoke the Lord to anger. Wicked things, okay? For they serve idols, whereof the Lord had said unto them, ye shall not do this thing. And they followed vanity and became vain. All the foolish things, all the stupid things that people waste their money on. Wigs, buying all these wigs, doing their nails, spending all this money on your nails and on your hair. What's wrong with your hair? Okay. For they serve idols, whereof the Lord had said unto them, ye shall not do this thing. And they followed vanity, became vain, and went after the heathen that were round about them, concerning whom the Lord had charged them that they should not do like them. And they left all the commandments of the Lord their God and made them molten images. You know, the little crosses with the dead body on it? You're not supposed to worship a dead body. How are you going to put a cross with a dead body? Jesus is resurrected. He's not dead. Okay? That's a curse. Okay? That's a cursed object. You can have a cross, but you can't put a dead body on it. Christ is resurrected. He's in glory, not suffering anymore. He's alive now. Okay, whom the Lord had charged them that they should not do like them. Okay, we're not supposed to do like these nations, like those false churches, like the Catholic Church and all those other false churches, okay? That's why Christ, in the book of Revelation, called the Catholic Church Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. If the Catholic Church is called the mother of harlots, you know who the daughter harlots are? All those other churches that came out of the Catholic Church are the daughter harlots. The mother harlot is the Catholic Church. The daughter harlots are all those other churches. Okay? The people in the churches are good, but their leaders have misled them and deceived them and exploited them. Okay? And that's why I'm doing this show, to set the record straight. And they left all the commandments of the Lord their God and made them molten images, even two calves, and made a grove and worshiped all the host of heaven and served Baal. Baal is Sunday worship and Christmas. That's Baal. They caused their sons and their daughters to pass through the fire, witchcraft, all these things that our people into Santeria, voodoo, and all these things, and used divinations and enchantments, and sold themselves to do evil in the sight of the Lord, to provoke him to anger. Therefore, the Lord was very angry with Israel and removed them out of his sight. Now you know why all you so-called 12 tribes of Israel, the indigenous people of the Pacific, the Aborigines, and the so-called Hispanics, which are not Spanish, okay, and American Indians that are forced to speak Spanish from colonial times, and the North American Indians, the Tibetans, all these people are into idols, okay? All the 12 tribes of Israel, the Tibetans are following idols, worshiping idols. In Southeast Asia, the Negritos there are worshiping idols. The Philippines, they're following after the Catholic Church, which is only worshiping idols. Okay, the North American Indians are full of idol Hispanics. All the 12 tribes are suffering in slavery for the same reason, because they're following false gods, okay, and they're following lies instead of the truth. Okay, so that's the reason why that God removed them out of his sight. So let's see what happened to the 12 tribes after they were removed. Okay. So we know God was angry with the Israelites for breaking his commandments and going into following false gods. Therefore, God removed them. This is documented in the Bible in another place right here in 2 Kings 17. We find out the name of the king that removed the 10 tribes. The kingdom was divided into two parts. The southern kingdom was called Judea, and the northern was called Samaria, or Israel, okay, in the land of Samaria. So in 2 Kings 17, it tells you this. Verse 6, in the ninth year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria took Samaria and carried Israel away into Assyria. Samaria was the land where the 10 tribes were living. The king of Assyria carried Israel away into Assyria, which is in Mesopotamia, and placed them in Halal and in the harbor by the river of Gozan in the cities of the Medes. Okay, so the 10 tribes, they lost the northern land that they had, and they were removed into foreign lands. Okay, now during the time of King Solomon, almost 1,000 years before that time, they had ships. Solomon had navies, Pacific and an Atlantic navy, traveling the entire planet, mapping the entire globe, and bringing wealth to Solomon from every continent on the planet. And this is documented in the Bible. 1 Kings chapter 9, verse 22. The king had at sea a navy of Tarshish with the navy of Hiram. Okay, Tarshish is Spain. That's his Atlantic navy. Hiram is the Pacific Navy. He had two navies, one in the Atlantic Ocean, one in the Pacific Ocean. Once in 3 years came the Navy of Tarshish, bringing gold and silver and ivory and apes and peacocks. Those navies, they traveled the whole world. It took them 3 years. Every 3 years, they came back to Israel, bringing wealth to Solomon. Okay. Now, what happened is after the tribes were removed into Assyria, they knew about those lands. In fact, everyone knew about the lands, the world, the whole planet. The Bible tells you, it's recorded in the Bible that the earth, that we knew, our ancestors knew that the world was round. The Bible says very clearly, okay? It is he, in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 22, the Bible records that the earth is round. It is he, which is God, that sitteth upon the circle of the earth. The Bible says the earth is a circle, round, okay? Our ancestors and most of the people in the world always knew the earth was round. So the Europeans, it seems like they were the only ones that didn't know, that believed the earth was flat, because the Asians knew it, okay? This is a book called 1431, the year a magnificent Chinese fleet sailed to Italy and ignited the Renaissance, okay? This is a map right here that was brought to Italy, okay, in 1434 by a Chinese fleet, okay, showing the Italians and the Roman and the Europeans in Italy, the entire globe, a map of the entire globe. So they had a map of the globe. Columbus had a map in his hand when he came to America that was given to him by the Asians. And not only the Asians, every civilization knew that the earth was round. So they're trying to claim that they discovered it. That's a lie. There were people coming throughout the Americas, the Africas, the Asian continent for thousands of years before Columbus was born, okay? This is a good book that tells you that. And all the inventions and drawings that they gave credit to Michelangelo for, they were all plagiarized. All didn't come from Michelangelo. They were like from the Chinese records that the Chinese brought and showed to the Italians. And Michelangelo was given credit for those things when they were actually from Chinese books. Okay? So you can find all of this out. Okay? So the Renaissance in Italy was created by the Asians that came to Italy and brought them the crafts and the arts and the knowledge of medicine and sailing and you name it, okay? So after the king of Assyria removed the Israelites, where did they go? That's also recorded in the Bible. Okay? This is recorded in 2 Esdras chapter 13, verse 39. We're going to find out exactly where the Israelites went after that, right? Those are the 10, 2 Esdras chapter 13, verse 39 tells you where the 10 tribes went. Those are the 10 tribes. They took this counsel among themselves that they would leave the multitude of the heathen, which is the Middle East, okay, and go forth into a further country where never mankind dwelt. They were planning to come here to the new world. This was the only place that's not inhabited. For through that country there was a great way to go, namely of a year and a half. It took them a long time to come down to the Pacific and a lot of them to come out here to America. And the same regions called Arsareth. Arath is land. Arsareth, newfound land. Today you call it the new world. And that's the name that was given to it in the ancient time. The new land, the newfound land. Today you call it the new world. That's the Americas. Okay, so we're going to use a map to find out something here. So we see that the 10 tribes migrated, and they came to the Pacific and eventually to the Americas. Now, they had ships. They had ships. The Israelites had ships that were bigger than the ships of Columbus, see? And they were crossing the Pacific between America and the Pacific Islands back and forth. They had sailing technology superior to those of the Europeans and crossing for hundreds of years before the Europeans came here. Okay, so that's where the tribes ended up, in the Americas, and I'm going to prove this. We just read in the Bible that the 12 tribes of Israel came to America. How can we prove that? I'm going to prove it through you through genetics, and I'm going to prove it through you through history. Okay? And on top of the fact that I just showed you in the Bible that the tribes would come to America. How do we prove it genetically? This is the Y-DNA human migration haplogroups. In your blood, we all have 23 pairs of chromosomes in our bodies. The male carries the Y-DNA, the Y chromosome in the DNA, and that DNA has markers. The markers are known as, are classified in what is known as haplogroups, right? The haplogroup of the Israelite is this yellow mark that you see here for the most part, the yellow line. And it shows you how they came from the Middle East. This is the line of the Israelites, came into the Pacific Islands, and then they came over here to the Americas. So genetically, the Q, the C, and the M, and some other markers, this is the marker of the 12 tribes of Israel, okay? And you can see they're here in West Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, in the Pacific Islands, they came to America. So this map alone confirms that the genetic identity of the 12 tribes of Israel and where they went, where who they are related to. And we saw in the scripture that the 12 tribes of Israel lost their land and migrated from the old world to the new world. I'm going to read books, historical books, that confirm that to you, okay? Let's say, for example, this book. It's called History of the American Indians by James Adair. History of the American Indians. Okay. Adair was a great historian, and he wrote about the Native Americans and their genealogy and their ancestry. And I'm going to read some of the introduction here for you. In behalf of Adair, in his theory of the Jewish origin of the American Aborigines, it should be pointed out that a long line of writers, both before and after him, held the same view, okay? Soon after the discovery of America, the theory was advanced that the Indians derived from the lost tribes of Israel, okay? A great number of writers whose imaginations have been struck by the astonishing coincidences of many particulars of the customs and religious rites of some of the American Indians with those of the Jews, right? So that's one book, one of many books. Okay, History of the American proves to you that the American Indians descended. That's 500 pages of documents proving the American Indians descended from the 12 tribes of Israel. In this book, when an explorer came and met up with the American Indians, there was a tribe in Quito that spoke to him in fluent Hebrew. Okay, I'm going to read that for you. This is Lost Tribes in Promised Land, and this is page 364. It says here, right? She then turned to her male companion and explained the situation. Upon hearing her words, they rose, went over to Montezinos, and said, and to his utter astonishment said, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Ehad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. They had recited in Hebrew the fundamental creed of Judaism. They told him that they were themselves of the tribe of Reuben, okay, and that the tribe of Joseph lived on an island nearby. That the day when they were at last to issue forth into the world was coming soon. Okay, so these American Indians knew that they were descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay, and they spake in Hebrew, and they greeted the Merino Spanish explorer in the Hebrew tongue. This is documented in this book. Okay, I have more. There's another book, Origin of American Indians, okay, where they themselves tell you that they're descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel. This is in page 88, okay. Here. The most recent theory seemed to be that they are descendants from the 10 tribes of Israel. Okay? The tribe of Issachar. This descent was indicated by many of the customs, rites, and ceremonies common to the ancient Hebrews and modern Indians. Okay? So here we go, right here, right? He said here, right? The Mexicans are originally of the 10 tribes captured by Salmanasar and of the family of Issachar. It's true. The Mexican Indians are descendants of the tribe of Issachar. That's mentioned in Genesis 49 in the Bible, whom the Indians recognize as their ancestor. Okay? When the conquistadors and the Spaniards came here, the American Indians, a lot of them knew and was telling them that they are the Israelites. And this is documented in those books. So the Bible tells you that Israelites came to America. The Israelites in America, the American Indians themselves tell you that, yes, they are, in fact, the Israelites that came to America. They were telling them that. Okay? And then not only that, a lot of archaeological records were found. Even copies of Hebrew scripts, Hebrew manuscripts were found in the New World with God's name written, Yahweh. Okay? This is discovery of ancient America. This is the Ten Commandments written in Hebrew, found right here in America. Okay? And Hebrew scripts found throughout North, South, Central America. Okay? There's lots and lots of books about this. We know as a fact that the American Indians, they themselves said that they are the 12 tribes of Israel, and the Bible said they are the 12 tribes of Israel. Guess what? The genetic marker in their blood has been confirmed by scientists that the American Indians here, that we call American Indians, originally from the Middle East, okay? And that their haplogroup C and Q, and this is the haplogroup of the 12 tribes of Israel. And you see that yellow marker here, it goes to West Africa, parts of North Africa, and also the Pacific Aborigines, which is exactly why you see on my map that I have here listed, those are the people to be identified as the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, we just saw how the American Indians gave testimony to the fact that they are Israelites, that the Bible also proves that they are Israelites, and lots of historical evidence proving that they are Israelites. We also have the genetic map from the DNA migration pattern that proved that the Israelites came to the Americas. Now, I have additional information that's going to prove that the Pacific Aborigines and the American Indians are the same people because they are Israelites. This book is called American Indians in the Pacific. Okay, it's an old book, American Indians in the Pacific. It's written by Thor Heyerdahl. This book is significant because it proves that the American Indians and the Pacific Aborigines, such as the Hawaiians, the Polynesians, and people like that, are in fact the same people as the Hispanics and the American Indians, okay? This book is by Thor Heyerdahl. The title is American Indians in the Pacific. In this book, he shows you how the same identical phenotype that is found throughout the Pacifics, you know, like this girl here, she's from Alaska, and this girl here is from Polynesia. They look identical, okay? And here's another Maori princess from the South Pacific, and here's an American Indian girl. They look like they're related. Same thing here. You have a Northeast Indian Polynesian, and then here's an Easter Islander, Maori person. They look like they're related, okay? So the American Indians and the Pacific Aborigines, they look very similar because, in fact, they are descendants of the same ancestors. They are descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel. So this is a good book that you can read that shows the similarities, okay? The same totem poles that is found throughout the Pacific, the same style totem poles is found throughout the Americas, you know? So because it's the same people, the American Indians and the Pacific Aborigines are, in fact, the same people, okay? Okay, so we see that the northern 10 tribes, okay, migrated north and then east and into the Americas. So what happened to the southern tribes? The southern tribes went back into North Africa because they were driven into Africa by the Greeks and by the Romans that invaded them. Okay? They were being attacked by the Greeks, and then they were being attacked by the Romans, who eventually destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD. And the rest of the tribes that remained there was just three tribes: Judah, Benjamin, and Levi. Judah, Benjamin, and Levi. Judah is the Sephardim, the Igbo, and the Mandingo. Levi is found among the Bantu, the Ashanti, and the Maroons. And Benjamin is mostly the Pashtun and Afghani, and some of them are also found in parts of Central Africa. Okay, these tribes are primarily of the African type. Okay, they're dark in complexion, compared to the majority of the 10 tribes, which are light in complexion. So among the 12 tribes, we had people of different complexion, different texture of hair. You know, we're a mixed people because we're in captivity under many different nations from the very beginning, from the time we went into Egypt until the time of the kings. Israel was constantly being put into captivity by different nations. So because you had two different migration routes, the tribes look very different. The tribes that migrated east and northeast looked more like the Hispanics. The tribes that migrated south looked more like the Africans because they went into Africa, okay? So according to the Bible, the Jews of the Bible were described as being black, okay? We can read that in the Bible, okay? Lamentations chapter 4, verse 8, it says their visage, their visual facial appearance, their visage is blacker than a coal, okay? So they were black, okay, most of the Jews that fled south. Okay, and it says here in Lamentations verse chapter 5, verse 10, our skin was black like an oven. Okay, so that cannot be describing Europeans. Okay, the real Jews, according to the Bible, were people of color, different shades of brown. Okay, so that's the tribe of Judah and Levi and Benjamin, which is mixed among Judah. Okay, because the tribe of Benjamin was landlocked within Judea. Okay, now we did see where specifically it says in the Bible that the real Jews were people of color. But is there any other evidence that proves that? For example, we have pictures of Chinese that look like Chinese. They still look like Chinese today. We have pictures of the American Indians, and they still look like American. And what about the Jews of the Bible? Were they really brown people? Do we have pictures showing them that they're brown in complexion? Of course we do. These are the icons. icons were drawn by the Israelites of themselves. They would know what color they are. This book here, the icons. And as you could see, these people are brown. Okay? And this here is like a diagram of all the major prophets of the Bible drawn, depicted by the Israelites themselves, of their ancestors. And they're all people of color. See? None of them have blue eyes or blonde hair. If they were had blue eyes and blonde hair, so they did. If they were whatever. But the truth does matter. The true color of what they look like matters only because it's true. We cannot change something, call a frog a dog when it's a frog and not a dog. The Jews of the Bible were an Afro-Asiatic people of brown complexion. And the evidence, they themselves drew their own picture. They would know what they look like, right? What they themselves look like. They drew their picture, not with blonde hair and blue eyes, but as brown color people. This is one of several books, the icons. So we see that, that's why the Bible described Jesus Christ as being dark in complexion, Revelation 1, 14 and 15. And his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burn in a furnace. Christ didn't look like this. This is the Europeans. The Europeans were known, called the Edomites in the Bible. They were known as Esau, okay? And the very first European, the ancestor of the Europeans' name was Esau. I'm going to read that for you in Genesis chapter 25. I'm going to start from verse 23, okay? Verse 22, okay? And Isaac, verse 21 is better. And Isaac entreated the Lord. That's Genesis chapter 25, verse 21. We're going to read about where the first Caucasian came from, according to the Bible. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord was entreated of him. And Rebekah, his wife, conceived. And the children struggled together within her. And she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two matters of people shall be separated from thy bowels. So Rebekah, the wife of Isaac, had twins. Well, she was pregnant with twins. And those twins would separate and would become nations, okay? Verse 23, and the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manners of people shall be separate from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other, and the elder shall serve the younger, okay? And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb, okay? And the first came out red all over and like an hairy garment, and they call his name Esau. So the first child came out red, okay, like the Caucasian. And he had furry, hairy, his hair was like furry, straight, compared to Jacob that came out like everyone else there, like his father, dark in complexion, and he had woolly hair. Anatomically, African Americans and other people of Negro descent are classified as having woolly hair, and Christ is described as having woolly hair, and his head were white like wool, okay? And also in Daniel chapter 7, it tells you the Ancient of Days also was portrayed as having woolly hair, okay? So we can also read in Songs of Solomon, as well as in Job, that the ancient people were a people of different shades of brown, okay? So we have that. But the question is, if the people of the Bible, the real Jews of God, were a dark race, why do we have Europeans or Caucasians calling themselves Jews today, okay? So, but the mystery is very easily solved because the Bible warns us that there would be people in the last days claiming to be Jews that are not Jews. Okay, right here. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 9, the Bible says, I know the blasphemy by those who say they are Jews, Judaized, and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Revelation 3, 9, behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. Why? Because the Europeans converted to Judaism. they became Jewish by religion. It's just like a Chinese guy in China that became Muslim, and now he calls himself an Arab. That would be kind of stupid, right? So it's the same thing. These Europeans converted to Judaism, now they're calling themselves Jews. That's why God calls it blasphemy. I'm going to prove that. Okay. This is a book written by a Jewish author. His name is Kessler. He's going to give you the historical evidence behind that. Okay. We'll go to page 16 here, 17. The book is called The 13th Tribe by Arthur Kessler. Okay. The startling new discovery about the ancestry of the Jewish people. Okay. This is the true origin of Europeans who are calling themselves Jews. Okay. Because they're not. They're converted. And this is the history behind it. Okay. The history behind it. Kessler wrote this, right? The Khazars found themselves in a precarious position between the two major world powers, the Eastern Roman Empire in Byzantium and the followers of Muhammad. So you had a holy war between Christianity and Islam, right? And the middle part of Europe, to stay neutral in that war as a buffer zone, they chose a third religion called Judaism as a way of staying neutral in the war between Christianity and Islam. That's the reason why they converted to Judaism. So a lot of medieval tribes in Europe converted to Judaism as a way of staying neutral in the war between Christianity and Islam. That's why you have Caucasian Jews, because they converted. But according to the Bible, 1 Chronicles 9 and 1, you cannot convert to be a Jew. You've got to be a blood descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It says here, 1 Chronicles 9, so all Israel were reckoned by genealogy. You have to be a descendant by blood of the 12 tribes of Israel, or else you cannot call yourself a Jew. If you do, then the Bible said that's blasphemy. Them that say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Okay, I'm going to read what Kessler said. This was written long before the full extent. Okay, but that does not alter the fact that the large majority of surviving Jews in the world is of Eastern European, and thus perhaps mainly of Khazar origin. Okay, and it's true. Most of the so-called Jewish people are coming from Russia, from Poland to come to America and to go to Israel, when the real Jews came from Africa and Israel. Israel is part of Africa, by the way. Originally, that's the land of Canaan. Canaan is a descendant of Ham. Hamites are Africans. And Egypt, with Moses, Egypt is also in Africa. So these people are not coming from anywhere near that. They're coming all the way from Russia and from the middle, from the Caucasus, okay? If so, this would mean that, I'll read again, but that does not alter the fact that the large majority of surviving Jews in the world is of Eastern European, okay? So not African, Eastern European, and thus perhaps merely of Khazar origin. If so, this would mean that their ancestors came not from the Jordan but from the Volga, and not from Canaan but from the Caucasus, once believed to be the cradle of the Aryan race, and that genetically they are more closely related to the Huns, the Uyghur, the Magyar tribes than the seed of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Should this turn out to be the case, which it is the case, the term anti-Semitism would become void of meaning, okay, based on a misapprehension shared by both the killers and their victim. The story of the Khazar Empire as it slowly emerges from the past begins to look like the most cruel hoax which history has ever perpetrated. It's very cruel because these people are claiming to be Jews and taking someone else's history and identity for themselves and exploiting it to make money and to advantage of the world mentally and emotionally by claiming to be Jews when they're not. And God said that is blasphemy. So this is a book by Kessler that talks about this. And he goes here, okay, the Khazars found themselves in a precarious position with two major world powers, the Eastern Roman Empire in Byzantium and the triumphant followers of Muhammad. As Kessler points out, the Khazars were the third world of their day, and they chose a surprising method of resisting both the Western pressure to become Christian and the Eastern to adopt Islam. Rejecting both, they converted to Judaism. So that's why you have Caucasian Jews, because they're known as the Ashkenaz. Ashkenaz is a descendant of Japheth. They converted to Judaism. They're not the Jews that the Bible is talking about. There are several historical evidence to this. Here's the book. By this gentleman. His name is Michael Bradley. and chosen people from the Caucasus. Jewish origin, delusion, deception, a historical role. Okay, let's find out what he wrote. This is what Bradley wrote. Chosen people from the Caucasus focuses on the two separate groups of people who emerged from the Caucasus mountains of the Middle Ages. Those people who comprise the vast majority of modern Jewry who converted to Judaism about 740 AD and were later pushed into Central and Eastern Europe. So the Europeans had converted to Judaism. They are not originally the Jews of God. When you read in the Bible about the Jews, the 12 tribes of Israel, it's not talking about these people that you see in Israel today. It's not talking about these people that you see in America today calling themselves Jews. They're not Jews. They're converts to the Judaism religion, but they're not the blood descendant of the real Jews. The real Jews were driven into sub-Saharan Africa by the Romans and by the Greeks about 2,000 years ago. None of them went to Europe. Another way you can prove that is when you look at the DNA of the 12 tribes of Israel, that's the yellow line right here. Okay, you don't see any of that in Europe. Okay, it only came to the Pacific Islands, to America, and to West Africa. So none of the real Jews fled into Europe. A small remnant of them might be found all over the world, but the bulk of them are not found in Europe, so they cannot be coming from Europe. Okay, so here's another historian who wrote on the subject. This is by another rabbi, Moshe Lewis. History of Edom, the imposter Jew. Okay, because they're imposters, they're masquerading as Jews, calling themselves Jews, and they're not. They're Khazars, they're descendants of the Khazar. And what did he write here? Okay, this book clearly exposes the conspiracy intentionally perpetrated on the world by the descendants of Esau, otherwise known as Edom, who masqueraded themselves as Jews. It presents a detailed chronology of the Israelite history and a closely related group, the Edomites. So they're actually descendants of Esau. And Esau, when you read in the Bible, he was red. And when you look at them today, they're not black, like the Bible says. The real Jews would be different shades of brown. So I've shown you confessions from the Europeans themselves, the Khazars, the Jewish people themselves, so-called Jewish, that they're not Jews at all, and they're not supposed to be called Jews, that that's blasphemy according to God. From their own records, I've shown you that they are descendants of the Khazar Empire. They're not descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and they're not from the 12 tribes of Israel. This is Jewish History Atlas, okay? This is a Jewish History Atlas. You can get this any bookstore, library, wherever, any Jewish atlas. You could read about the Khazars. This is what it says about them. The Khazar Jewish kingdom from 700 to 1016 AD. That's how long that kingdom, the Khazars, lasted. It says here, the Khazar were a heathen nomad people from Central Asia. In about 700 AD, their king Bulan was converted to Judaism. A latter king, Obadiah, greatly strengthened Judaism. Okay. In 970, the Russians began attacking the Khazars and drove them into the Crimea. In 1016, a joint Russian-Byzantine expedition finally destroyed the Khazar kingdom. The Khazar Jews, because now they've converted to Judaism, became dispersed into Russia, Byzantine, and the Mediterranean ports. So you see, from their own writings, from their own historical atlas, they tell you that they're not Jews. They're descendants of Esau, and they're known as the Khazars in history. So the people in Israel are not Jews. The Ashkenazi ones in Israel are not. The Sephardic ones are Jews, but the Ashkenazis from Europe are not.
Now, any judge, when he charges a jury, says, gentlemen, any witness that you find has told a single lie, you can disregard all his testimony. That is correct. I don't know from what state you come, but in New York State, that is the way the judge addresses a jury. If that witness said one lie, disregard his testimony. Now, what are the facts? The Jews, I call them Jews to you because they're known as Jews. I don't call them Jews. I refer to them as so-called Jews because I know what they are. If Jesus was a Jew, there isn't a Jew in the world today. And if those people are Jews, certainly our Lord and Savior was not one of them. And I can prove that. Now what happened? The Eastern European Jews, who form 92% of the world population of those people who call themselves Jews, were originally Khazars. They were a warlike tribe that lived deep in the heart of Asia. And they were so warlike that even the Asiatics drove them out of Asia into Eastern Europe. And to reduce this, so you don't get too confused about the history of Eastern Europe, they set up this big Khazar kingdom. 800,000 square miles. Only, there was no Russia, there were no other countries, and the Khazar kingdom was the biggest country in all Europe. So big and so powerful that when the other monarchs wanted to go to war, the Khazars would loan them 40,000 soldiers. That's how big and powerful they were. Now, they were phallic worshippers, which is filthy. I don't want to go into the details of that now. It was their religion, the way it was the religion of many other pagans or barbarians elsewhere in the world. Now, the king became so disgusted with the degeneracy of his kingdom that he decided to adopt a so-called monotheistic faith, either Christianity, Islam, the Muslim faith, or what is known today as Judaism, really Talmudism. So, by spinning a top, he said, eeny, meeny, miny, moe, and he picked out so-called Judaism. And that became the state religion, and he sent down to Talmudic schools of Tel Aviv and Surah, and brought up thousands of these rabbis with their teachings, and he opened up synagogues and schools in his kingdom of 800,000 people, 800,000 square miles, and maybe 10 to 20 million people, and they became what we call Jews. There wasn't one of them that ever had an ancestor that ever put a toe in the Holy Land, not alone in Old Testament history, but back to time, the beginning of time. Not one of them. And yet they come to the Christians and they ask us to support their armed insurrection in Palestine by saying, well, you want to certainly help repatriate God's chosen people to their promised land, their ancestral homeland, Italy. We gave you one of our boys as your Lord and Savior. You now go to church on Sunday and kneel, and you worship a Jew, and we are Jews. Well, they were pagan Khazars who were converted just the same as the Irish. And it's just as ridiculous to call them people of the Holy Land as it would be there are 54 million Chinese Muslims. 54 million. And Muhammad only died in 620 A.D., so in that time, 54 million Chinese have accepted Islam as their religious belief. Now imagine in China, 2,000 miles away from Arabia, where the city of Mecca is located, where Muhammad was born, imagine if the 54 million Chinese called themselves Arabs. Imagine. Why, you'd say they're lunatics. Any man that believes that those 54 million Chinese are Arabs must be crazy. All they did was adopt as a religious faith a belief that had its origin in Mecca, in Arabia. The same as the Irish. When the Irish became Christians, nobody jumped them in the ocean and imported from the Holy Land a new crop of inhabitants that were Christians, that had Christian flesh and blood. They weren't different people. They were the same people, but they had accepted Christianity as their religious faith. Now these pagans, these Asiatics, these Turco-Finns, they were a mongoloid race. who were forced out of Asia into Eastern Europe, they likewise, because their king took the faith, the Talmudic faith, they had no choice. Just the same as in Spain. If the king was Catholic, everybody had to be a Catholic. If not, you had to get out of Spain. So everybody, they lived on the land, just like the trees in the bushes. A human being belonged to the land under their feudal system. So they all became what we call today Jews. Now imagine how silly it was for the Christians, for the great Christian countries of the world to say, we are going to use our power, our prestige, to help repatriate God's chosen people to their ancestral homeland, their promised land. Now, could there be a bigger lie than that? Could there be a bigger lie than that? And because they control the newspapers, the magazines, the radio, the television, the book publishing business, they have the ministers in the pulpit, they have the politicians on the soapboxes talking the same language. So naturally, you'd believe black is white if you heard it often enough. You wouldn't call black black anymore. You'd start to call black white, and nobody could blame you.
So I've shown you biblical evidence. I've shown you historical evidence. And I've given you genetic evidence to prove who the real Israelites are. And I've shown you historical evidence, and I've shown you genetic evidence to prove to you who the 12 tribes of Israel are not. So we know who they are and who they are not. Now we're going to go in the Bible and get more documentation and in terms of the prophetic condition and characteristics revealed in the Bible that will pertain to the 12 tribes of Israel. What are the conditions and characteristics that pertain to the Israelites that will identify them in the last days? This is found in Deuteronomy 28, in Genesis 49, Deuteronomy 33, and many other chapters in the Bible. In fact, the entire Bible can prove to you who the 12 tribes of Israel really is, because no one else will match the condition those characteristics described except the people of the Bible in their entirety. Okay, so Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 15 says this. But it shall come to pass, God talking to the 12 tribes of Israel, right? That if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which he commanded thee this day, verse 15, right? That all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. When you look at the Israelites, they're in a cursed condition. They went through slavery. They went through colonization. They lost their identity. All these things are mentioned in the Bible as conditions that would identify the Israelites and no other nation in their entirety when you consider all the things that happened to them. Okay? What are some of the curses that befall the Israelites, right? For example, the scripture says right here that the Israelites would be sold, okay? Deuteronomy 28. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, okay? Now, to go from Egypt to Israel, you don't need ships. You could just walk, okay? But the new Egypt that it's talking about, it's America. That's the new place where they went into slavery, okay? Because Deuteronomy 28 is way after Moses, after the Israelites came into the land. So it's talking about a new Egypt. How do you know that? When you go to Revelation chapter 11, it tells you that America is spiritually called Sodom and Egypt. Sodom because of all the homosexuality that's going on here, and Egypt because of all the slavery that the world is under because of this, and all the slavery that took place in the Americas, of the American Indians as well as the blacks that were in slavery here in this country for 400 years. So this is the new Egypt, right? And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships. That's how the Jews got here. The real Jews of the Bible came here on slave ships. According to the Bible, that's how it would happen. The Europeans that are calling themselves Jews didn't come here on slave ships. The Bible said the real Jews would come on slave ships. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships. By the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. According to God, the real Jews wouldn't be in Israel, not until Jesus Christ comes to bring them back. Christ didn't come to bring them back yet, so the people that are there cannot be Jews, okay? Okay. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee, which is the Middle East. Thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen. The Israelites would be sold as slaves to their enemies. And most of the American Indians and the Hispanics and the blacks are treated as enemies. Okay, when you go to look in the prison system, there's like more than 2 million people in jail here, and most of them are people of color. Okay, and the poverty, you name it, that's them. Okay, and here is the documentation right here. The Bible said that they would be sold. Joel chapter 3, verse 6. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians. The Grecians are the colonial powers here. Okay? The colonial powers of America. Okay? That ye might remove them far from their borders. Okay? They were sold here. Okay? Okay? Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people. Okay? See that? The Arabs were the primary ran the slave market, selling the Israelites to the European powers. Okay? Thy sons and thy daughters, the Bible says in Deuteronomy 28, verse 32, thy sons and thy daughters will be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thine hands. Okay? So, the Israelites, we're still in captivity in this land. You know, we still have no independence. We still cannot, carry out our culture and our traditions and our laws according to the Bible. We don't even have our identity. We're not even calling ourselves by our proper identity as the 12 tribes of Israel. So they're in a mental, physical, emotional, psychological prison. Okay, they're still in prison in this society. Okay. And let's see here. And God said that all these conditions, right? In Deuteronomy 28, verse 46, and they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder and upon thy seed forever. The fact that you'd come on slave ships and then you'd have yokes of iron upon your neck. And Deuteronomy 28, verse 48, and ye shall put, and he, in slavery time, you'd have a yoke of iron, okay? And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck, okay? You'd be chained. You'd come here on slave ships, and you would be chained according to the Bible, and kept in chains, until he have destroyed thee. And we were destroyed through that process in terms of our identity, in terms of our culture, in terms of our families, in terms of our economic power and community. You were completely destroyed as a people through this process. Until he have destroyed thee. Why? Because we didn't keep God's commandments and we don't repent and come back to doing God's commandments. That's why we're in that condition. Okay. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 45 says this, moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes which he commanded thee. Okay? And they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder and upon thy seed forever. So these curses that befell the Israelites historically and these conditions and characteristics that we find ourselves in would serve as a marker to identify us as the 12 tribes of Israel. Because, for example, the Europeans want to call themselves Jews, but they cannot match those curses and conditions and characteristics. They didn't come here on slave ships. They did not have yokes of iron upon their necks. Their daughters were not sold into slavery. Okay? They didn't go into this kind of captivity for 400 years. Okay? That's the real Holocaust. The real Holocaust is what the American Indians and the African Americans so-called went through in America. That's the real Holocaust. There was no other Holocaust that happened in the Western world. This is it. Okay? Because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things, therefore shalt thou serve thine enemies which the Lord shall send against thee in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness in the want of all things. Okay? In the African-American communities, like in Harlem and other places, other ghettos where they live, you'll find Arab stores. You'll find all types of everyone else owning stores and owning businesses in those communities except for them. They don't own anything. Okay? They have to rent from other nations. They have to, whatever they need. They're so dependent for everything they want. They're serving their enemies for the want of all things. The people that's calling themselves Jews, they own everything. So they don't even match those conditions and characteristics of the Holy Bible. We are the only ones, only the true descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel match those conditions, which is the descendants of the Aborigines of the Pacific, the Sub-Saharan West Africans that came here in slavery, and also the Philippines, the Sakai of and Sili of China, North China, and parts of North India, the Bena Menashe, the Negritos of Burma, Laos, and Thailand, and the Pashtun of Afghanistan. Those are all the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel, and they all suffer these characteristics and conditions that we've listed here. But God also gives us the geographical, specific geographical location of those tribes as well. This is in Genesis chapter 49 and Deuteronomy chapter 33. Okay? I'm going to read it. Genesis chapter 49, concerning the last days, what's the condition of the 12 tribes, right? Genesis 49 says this, "And Jacob called unto his sons," Jacob is the father of the 12 tribes of Israel, "and said, gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days." In the last days is now. We're living in the last days before the second coming of Yeshua, who is Jesus Christ. These are the 12 tribes of Israel. We're going to read now the geographical, the characteristics pertaining to the geographical location of the 12 tribes. Okay? We'll just take, let's take this one. Central America, right? Issachar. Mexico, right? Genesis 49 verse 14 says this, "And Issachar," Central America, what's the condition that would describe them in the last days, right? "Issachar is a strong ass couching down between two burdens." The ass or the donkey and the two burdens. And this is Issachar, a Central American, a Mexican. Every time, it's like a national symbol for Mexico. Shows you a donkey with the two loads, okay, and a man, you know, guiding it. So that's the characteristics of the tribe of Mexico in Central America. I also read to you in this book how it identifies, the Mexicans are identified as the tribe of Issachar by historians, if you remember. This book called Origin of the American Indian backs up what the Bible is saying right here. Origins of the American Indians, page 88, says this. The Mexicans are originally of the 10 tribes captured by Salmanazar and of the family of Issachar, whom the Indians recognized as their special ancestor. The American Indians of Central America knew that their ancestor was of the tribe of Issachar. And the Bible described Issachar as crouching down between two burdens, with a donkey crouching down between two burdens, which is like a national symbol that all over the world people recognize as Mexicans. Okay? What else we have here? Gad. Gad is the North American Indians. North American Indians. The Ainu, the Tibetans, they're all Gad. Okay? Gad, a troop shall overcome him. Genesis 49, verse 19. But he shall overcome at the last. What happened to Gad, right? The American cavalry overtook Gad and took their land. That's how America got this land. They got it from the American Indians. The Bible described that as would be what the condition that would take place to identify the tribe of Gad. Okay? And I have books there concerning the American Indians claiming themselves as Israelites, which you saw earlier. Okay? And Deuteronomy 33 verse 20 said this, and of Gad he said, blessed be he that enlargeth Gad. Of all the tribes of Israel, the North American Indians had the most land. Okay, North America is mostly the land of the tribe of Gad. Okay, and of Gad he said, blessed be he that enlargeth Gad. He dwelleth as a lion. Okay, a lion lives in nature. Okay, the American Indians used to live in perfect harmony with nature. Blessed be he that enlargeth Gad. He dwelleth as a lion and teareth the arm with the crown of the head. Okay, they had a very peculiar ritual where they made a cut with, you know, on their skin, and the other guy would cut his skin and they would join it together and become blood brothers. See, he teareth the, what it says over here, 1 second. He dwelleth as a lion, he teareth the arm with the crown of the head. The crown is the bonnet with feathers, unusual crown, which is the bonnet with feathers that the American Indians wear. So that's a complete description of the American Indians. Okay. Genesis chapter 49, verse 33, gives us the characteristics and the conditions of the tribe of Zebulun in the last days. It says this, Genesis 49, verse 13, Zebulun shall dwell at the haven of the sea, and he shall be for an haven of ships. Okay, a haven of ships means it's a place where ships go to. In other words, it would be like a major naval base or a major ports. Okay, in the sea. Okay, the sea where people are dwelling at right now, where they have the majority of people living in, is the Pacific Ocean. You have several nations in the Pacific Oceans compared to the Atlantic Ocean. You have like over 1 billion people living in the Pacific Ocean. Okay, so of the tribes of Israel that are scattered around the world, the Philippines is that haven of ships, because every nation, every colonial power always want to use the Philippines as a naval base. The Japanese had it as a naval base. The Spaniards during colonial times had it as a naval base for over 400 years. Then America had it as a naval base. According to Genesis 49, verse 13, in the last days, the Philippines would be where the tribe of Zebulun would be found. Okay, that's where the haven of ships is located. Okay. According to Genesis chapter 49, in the last days, the characteristics pertaining to the tribe of Naphtali indicate that there would be the Polynesians and the Micronesians. So Genesis chapter 49, verse 20 on Naphtali is a hen let loose. He giveth goodly words. For example, the Hawaiians, the Polynesians, those are the most friendliest people. You come to their country, they greet you with aloha, a very friendly word, very, very friendly term. They put flowers on you. Very, very nice. Okay? Also, Deuteronomy 33 tells you, O Naphtali, he said, O Naphtali, satisfied with favor and full of the blessings of the Lord. Look how beautiful their land is, the beautiful ocean where they live. Take possession of the sea and the south. And that's where those islands are located, in the sea, the Pacific, and the South Pacific. That's the condition and characteristic that would allow us to locate the tribe of Naphtali in the last days. According to Genesis chapter 49, verse 3, the tribe of Reuben in the last days would be the Australian Aborigines. And this is the verse that described the condition that points to them. Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity, and the excellency of power. Unstable as water, thou shalt not excel. Okay? So, Reuben has a curse on them, because of what the Reuben did. It says that the tribe of Reuben would not excel. Okay? And of all the 10 tribes that migrated through the Pacific, the tribe that's the poorest and live in the lowest condition is the Australian Aborigines. Even up until now, they live in a very bad situation economically, the worst situation in terms of poverty and in terms of development, okay? So in terms of development, the tribe of Reuben would be the least developed. And this is the condition they exist in up until now. According to Genesis chapter 49, verse 8, the tribe of Judah would be found at the neck of that their enemy. The enemy that is talking about is the United States, because that's where they were in slavery. And that's who is controlling the world and policing the world today. That's the last head of the Roman Empire, which is America. So that's where the tribe of Judah would be found. I'll read it. Genesis 49, verse 8. Okay. Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. Because Jesus Christ came out of that tribe, okay? Thine hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies, okay? Wherever you see the European, Caucasian, the American powers, whenever you see a political activities taking place, whenever there's major political changes taking place in America, usually the African Americans are behind it. Okay, like Martin Luther King, like Malcolm X, these people, they changed America. Okay, and right in the White House, what do you have? Barack Obama. Okay, he's African American. He's at the very neck of his enemy. Okay, so that's the tribe of Judah. The tribe of Judah is mostly the blacks of sub-Saharan West Africa and the African Americans of America. They are at the neck of the enemy. Okay, that's who Judah is. Now we're going to find out what's the future of the 12 tribes of Israel. Are they going to stay dispersed? Is God going to save them? Are they going to be delivered? Let's see what happened. I'm going to read Isaiah chapter 14. And there, chapter 14, verse 1, God says what he's planning for the Israelites. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob. Okay. And will yet choose Israel and set them in their own land. So the Lord said that he's going to take the Israelites, the 12 tribes, and bring them back to their own land. Okay? For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel and set them in their own land. And the strangers shall be joined with them. And they shall cleave to the house of Jacob. So the Most High is going to bring back the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay, he's going to gather them from all the places where they were dispersed. So God is going to send a savior and a deliverer, just like God had Moses to deliver the Israelites out of Egypt the first time. God is going to send Jesus Christ to deliver the 12 tribes of Israel into the kingdom of heaven. I'm going to read here, okay? And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, or Yeshua, for he shall save his people from their sins. Okay, so Christ is going to be the sacrifice, okay, that's going to pay for the sins of the Israelite. It tells you right here in John 3:16, we all know this scripture, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Okay? So Christ is the one that's coming to deliver the 12 tribes of Israel out of this condition of captivity once they repent and return back to God, following the commandments of Yahweh in the Bible. When they come back, when the 12 tribes of Israel stop calling themselves black and Hispanics and Negroes and Indians and you name it, by colonial names, once they turn from those false identities, number one. Number two, when they learn to have love for one another and for other people, like Christ had, then God will turn back the curses from them and restore them as a people, as a community, as a family, and as a nation among nations. We have such a vast, such an infinite, such an incredible future, okay? But how can you be part of that future? You have to realize that God loves you, and that's why he made the world, okay? John 3:16, you're familiar with that. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that so whosoever believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Okay? And you got to realize that everyone is guilty of sin. So don't think that, oh, you're too far gone, you're not good enough for God. We're all good enough for that Christ died for us, okay? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. No one is perfect. So God does not expect you to be perfect. God knows that you have flaws. And but the thing is, you committed sins, okay? So you have to pay for these sins, okay? If you cannot pay for your sins, you have to burn in hell. But there's a person that paid for your sin, that's Jesus Christ. Realize that the Lord required that a price must be paid for sin. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, okay? Christ's name is Yehoshua in the Hebrew, okay? Realize that the Lord Yeshua, Hamashiach means the Messiah, Jesus Christ, died to pay the price required for your sins, okay? It tells you that in Romans 6:23. For God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So if you don't accept Christ to pay for your sins, the only other way you can pay for it is in hell. So you accept Christ, you go to heaven. You don't accept Christ, you go to hell. Once you accept Christ, you have to be baptized. You got to turn from your sins. You got to keep the commandments of God. Okay? The best you can. Okay. Number 5, repent of your sins, ask the Heavenly Father to forgive you in the name of his Son, Lord Yeshua, and be baptized so that you may receive everlasting life. Romans 10:9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Okay, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God will not lie. He's not a man. He cannot lie. So if the Bible said you'll be saved if you accept Jesus Christ, be baptized and turn away from your sins, that's exactly what's going to happen. Okay? Repent and be baptized. Acts chapter 2:38. Every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Okay? The gifts of the Holy Spirit is all the power and all the glory, all the eternal life, and everything that the Lord God has in store for you in the kingdom of heaven, for all eternity, beyond anything you can comprehend, okay? If you accept Christ, you can say this a prayer along these lines, okay? Just say, Lord Father in heaven, thank you for sending your son, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross to pay for my sins committed against you, your biblical laws and commandments. Confess to God your sins so that I will not have to burn in everlasting hellfire after death. Lord Yeshua, thanks for redeeming me by bearing my punishment. I want to know you personally, and I open the doors of my life and receive you as my Lord and Savior. If you say a prayer sincerely to God and you turn from your sins and you baptize yourself, then you will receive the salvation of God. You'll be part of the eternal kingdom of heaven, which is something beyond any imagination. Okay, so make sure you tune in again into our program so we can explain this to you in much greater detail and go through the prophecy and then the history in a lot greater detail. All right? So thank you for tuning in. This is the Israelite Network. And our motto is repent, unite, rebuild, okay? We have to repent from our evil ways as a people, as a community, as a nation, as a world. This world has to repent, okay? Without repentance, you can't get anywhere. Unite. Once you cannot unite unless you first repent and do things right, okay? You unite, and then to unite for what purpose? To rebuild. And what do you unite under? You unite under the Holy Bible, the laws and commandments of God, which is why we're suffering, okay? Because we have not repented and turned back to God. And we build, what are we rebuilding? The community, the nation, the families, and ourselves as individuals in the image and likeness of God. How can we do this? Repent, unite, and rebuild? We got to do it together, okay? We're trying to put together capital committees. We're putting together resources and information. You need to do your part. You need to send in some kind of support to this organization. You need to get involved. You need to come in and get connected to this, okay, so that you don't have to just keep complaining and complaining and make a change in your life. Go on our website. Give us a call. You can send away for the books. Go to any bookstore and order it. Go to the website. Okay? There's no excuse. We're here. This is the time. You're out of time. This is it. It's now or never. Thank you.